Lutheran Church, Springfield, Ohio. Today is July 1st, 2018. St. John's is located at 27 North Wittenberg Avenue, Springfield, Ohio. Our telephone number is 937-323-7508. Our pastor is the Reverend John H. Pollock.
Good morning, everyone, and welcome to our worship service this morning. We give a special welcome to our visitors. If you're new in the Springfield, Pike County area, or looking for a new church home, we invite you to make St. John your new church home. We begin with the order of confession and forgiveness on page 94 in the front of our worship book. And I invite those who can do so without difficulty to please stand as we prepare our hearts and minds. Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
God of all mercy and consolation, come to the help of your people, turning us from our sin to live for you alone. Give us the power of your Holy Spirit, that we may confess our sin, receive your forgiveness, and grow into the fullness of Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord.
Amen.
Let us confess our sin in the presence of God and of one another. Most merciful God, we confess that we are captive to sin and cannot free ourselves. We have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done, and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us. Forgive us, renew us, and lead us, so that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways, to the glory of your holy name. Amen. God, who is rich in mercy, loved us even when we were dead in sin and made us alive together with Christ. By grace you have been saved. In the name of Jesus Christ, your sins are forgiven. Almighty God, strengthen you with power through the Holy Spirit, that Christ may live in your hearts through faith. Amen. We begin our worship with hymn number 779 in the back of your worship book, Amazing Grace, How Sweet the Sound. Hymn number 779.
Amen.
47 in the front of your worship. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
And also with you.
Now, page 149. This is the feast of victory for our God. Alleluia. He is Christ, the Lamb who was slain, who God set us free to be people of God.
Singleton.
Good morning. The first reading is from Lamentations, 3rd chapter. The steadfast love of the Lord never ceases. His mercies never come to an end. They are new every morning. Great is your faithfulness. The Lord is my portion, says my soul. Therefore, I will hope in him. The Lord is good to those who wait for him, to the soul that seeks him. It is good that one should wait quietly for the salvation of the Lord. It is good for one to bear the yoke in youth, to sit alone in silence when the Lord has imposed it, to put one's mouth to the dust, there may yet be hope, to give one's cheek to the smiter and be filled with insults. For the Lord will not reject forever. Although he causes grief, he will have compassion according to the abundance of his steadfast love. For he does not willingly afflict or grieve anyone. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
I will exalt you, O Lord, because you have lifted me up.
Thank you.
8th chapter. Now as you excel in everything, in faith, in speech, in knowledge, in utmost eagerness, and in our love for you, so we want you to excel also in this generous undertaking. I do not say this as a command, but I am testing the genuineness of your love against the earnestness of others. For you know the generous act of our Lord Jesus Christ, that though he was rich, yet for your sakes he became poor, so that by his poverty you might become rich. And in this matter, I am giving my advice. It is appropriate for you who began last year not only to do something, but even to desire to do something. Now finish doing it, so that your eagerness may be matched by completing it according to your means. For if the eagerness is there, the gift is acceptable according to what one has, not according to what one does not have. I do not mean that there should be relief for others and pressure on you, but it is a question of a fair balance between your present abundance and their need, so that their abundance may be for your need, in order that there may be a fair balance. As it is written, the one who had much did not have too much, and the one who had little did not have too little. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
If you would like to sit during the two
two-hour increment in our booth at the fair. The sign-up sheet is outside Charlotte's office, which is in the door down the hall, if you're not aware of where Charlotte's office is. Now for our special music, we will have William Anders, who will play his viola, and bear with me on this, I've been dealt with classical music in years, so he's playing Andante, a rondo, and grazie by Carl Marie Bond.
William is the grandson of our member Sally and Dr. Jim Pompousius.
Thank you. We never get anything done. You
spend all our time in bed. So this begins the one, the attraction. Second, he said, was intimacy. This is the emotional part of it. This is when you start becoming emotionally attached to someone. Again, this doesn't happen 10 out of 10, 24 hours a day, 7 days a week. Our emotions ebb and flow with sometimes how we are due to our physical health, our emotional health, our mental health, outside forces, all kinds of things can affect our emotion and affect how much intimacy we have with our partner. And then we come to the foundation, the basis, and that is commitment. This is willful. This is not emotion. This is not hormones. This is you making that decision to commit. I'm asked sometimes by people, well, why can't people just live together? Why do they have to get married? Because living together is an arrangement. Marriage is a commitment. And this is the most important part of marriage, and this is why oftentimes marriage just falls apart. Because that commitment is lost. Commitment is where we meet Jesus Christ. Commitment is where we need the power of the Holy Spirit. Because there's all kinds of forces out there fighting against your commitment to your spouse. A Christian sociologist by the name of Gary Smalley, back in the 80s, came out with a book that was put into a video series called Love is a Decision. It was all based on this idea of that commitment. Then reach a point in marriage where the passion isn't as great as it looks. And some people feel that they think, well, I need a new partner. Where's all that passion we had when we were first married? But some begin to lose the intimacy. Sometimes somebody's not as intimate as the other person. But what keeps a marriage together is the decision to stay committed. That you have enough invested in this relationship that you overcome the problems. So St. Paul then gives us the Christian triangle, or the triangular theory of how love works, how marriage is endured, influenced by our faith. If you have a Bible, you turn to Colossians, the third chapter. So you got Acts, Romans, 1st, 2nd Corinthians, Galatians, Ephesians, Philippians, Colossians. Chapter 3, beginning, and for those of you who need help, is at the back of the book, not the front. All right, verse 12. Put on then as God's chosen ones, holy and beloved, compassionate hearts, kindness, humility, meekness, and patience. Bearing with one another, and if one has a complaint against another, forgiving each other as the Lord has forgiven you, so you also must forgive. And above all these things, put on love, which binds everything together in perfect harmony. And let the peace of Christ rule in your hearts, to which indeed you were called in one body, and be thankful. Let the word of Christ dwell in you richly, teaching and admonishing one another in all wisdom, singing psalms and hymns and spiritual things with thankfulness in your hearts to God. So, the three bases for Christian marriage. First is, when he says, bury with one another, the word literally means to endure. So that's the first problem of our triangle. The word also has that you did not realize you had come to believe or were influenced. And the problem is that partners come together with different lists. And that is in regards to the roles of one another. Like an example, there was a couple who was married. The husband in his family, the father handled all the finances. He had a back room in the house where he did the finances. His mother, kids never knew how much money they had or didn't have. He kept it all to himself. It was a secret. His wife, in her situation, her father traveled. So her mother handled the books, all the finances. So when they got married, of course, the husband, coming out of the role of his father of handling finances, tried to handle finances, and he was terrible at it. You're constantly getting overdue notices, and you're going to cut off your water or electricity, whatever, because they hadn't paid the bill. So finally, he turned it over to his wife, and everything went smooth. One wife complained about her husband, saying, "Well, my dad would always take mom's car and have it filled up with gas and have it washed once a week. My husband's not doing that." Well, the husband, his father didn't do that for his mother, so why didn't he know, why should I do it? So we have to endure through the differences that we have that come about, either from the culture we were raised in or the neighborhood we were raised in, even in different states of state, depending on who is predominant in the culture of that state. And so endure, to bear with one another, to bear with the difficulties and everything else that may happen. And you have to be able to handle those without being resentful. Because you're going to be different. Another marriage couple, he had been in the military. She, according to him, had been spoiled. She said she was nurtured growing up. He said she was old growing up. You know, coming out of the military, did the laundry, everything was folded neat, put neatly in the drawers. She would do the laundry, open up her drawer, and just dump the stuff in. You know, she'd take a shower, just throw the towel on the floor, and leave it there. And say, "You know, you couldn't pick up the towel." She'd leave dishes in the sink. She said, "You know, you couldn't put them in the dishwasher." She said, "Man, I can leave the towel on the floor, and I can leave the dishes in the sink. It's not that big of a deal, but it doesn't deal with us." She liked museums, especially art museums. She liked the opera. She liked swing dancing and ballroom dancing. He wouldn't go to disco dancing. So they had to come to a compromise. She agreed to take some disco lessons. He went to the art museum and to the opera and so forth. Gene and I've never known the ballet with her, but I did conceive to go to the opera for 4 weeks in a row or something. Actually, I like opera, but 4 weeks in a row is a little much. Like, can we have a break in there or something? Especially when one was a Wagnerian opera that's 4.5 hours long, and all the other operas were 2.5 hours long. Like, we ever going to get out of here? So you endure with one another. You endure with, thank God for him as one of the 10 that come up in your marriage. The second is forgiveness. And this is a big deal. You have to be willing to forgive. As Paul says, bearing with one another, if one has a complaint, that means a grievance or a reason to blame you for something against another, forgiving each other. That means to be gracious with, to pardon each other, to be kind. As the Lord has forgiven you, so you must forgive. He doesn't say you should forgive, or hopefully you'll forgive. He says you must forgive. If you're in that marriage relationship, you must forgive. That word must has a meaning of this is the way it's supposed to be. This is the channel you're supposed to take. It means to forgive as Christ forgave. And that's the hardest thing in a marriage for couples when one feels like they have been hurt, especially really bad, to forgive. Because you feel like the your spouse is hurting so bad that they're beyond forgiveness. The St. Paul's reminding us of Jesus. Now Jesus forgave no matter what happened. He forgave the people that nailed him to the cross, which in reality was all of us. But that day, their first Good Friday, he didn't curse the Romans who nailed him to the cross like the two thieves did. But he forgave all the time. I mean, he forgave Peter, who had said I would even stand by him no matter what, and of course denied him three times. He forgave all people, the disciples who didn't become the apostles after the resurrection, for deserting him. Only one who did was John. John, the only one who has the nerve to stay with him to show up at the cross and become the caretaker of Mary, the mother of our Lord. So forgiveness. We have to forgive. You cannot hold things in. There'll be conflicts, emotional conflicts, financial conflicts, intimacy conflicts. There's even infidelity. St. Paul's telling us through our faith in Jesus Christ, we can forgive, and that goes back to that word, commitment. To make that decision, to willfully decide that you are going to stay together, no matter what was happening. When, I'm not going to dwell on this a lot, but when Gina gave the sermon on the 40th anniversary, she mentioned that we had had a conflict in our marriage a long time ago. And it hadn't been the moment for us to be committed to each other and forgive. We wouldn't need it. But we determined to work out the problems and stay committed. In today's society, it makes it too easy to just walk away. It's, well, why do I do that? And we're not talking about abuse. Don't misunderstand. I'm not saying somebody involved in an abusive relationship or a spouse who's got alcohol problems or drug problems that they can just stay committed no matter what. I'm talking about is the normal things that cause people to divorce. What is it? The common thing now that they give is a kind of cover all for divorce. It's an irreconcilable difference. Or irreconcilable difference. Well, nations have ever reconciled the difference, they sit down and hammer it out. So you can do that and go to war. In a nuclear age, you don't want to go to war. So forgiveness is so important to be able to make that commitment work. And the third, and the foundation, just like commitment was a foundation in Dr. Sternberg's study, for us, that foundation, which involves commitment, is love. We're not talking about love in TV and in movies. The romantic novels, you know, used to talk about the dime store novels. Of course, there's no dime anymore. You can't buy anything on the paper for dime anymore. Definitely not the book. But those kind of romantic novels, maybe they all talk about the happily ever after. Nobody loves happily ever after in the true sense of it. Have all kinds of problems. You have financial setbacks. You may have a problem with your child. And Gina shared with you how when Matthew was 3 years old, he got this bizarre disease that you only did to dad in South America. It was supposed to come back. Poor old Matthew looked like a poster child for the Biafra famine going on that time in Africa. He was so skinny, his legs were much bigger than my finger. But, you know, that put a stress on us. So, there's all kinds of things that happen in marriage, but with love, the true type of love, you can keep that tender. When St. Paul talks about love, he says, and above all this, put on love, which binds everything together. That word bind means that which unifies. The word love, that word that is only in the New Testament, and used only to describe God. though we think we can come up with a better idea than he does, he still loves us so much. He makes salvation so easy. Simply by believing in this. And his atoning death on the cross and his resurrection from the dead. So we're not talking about hormonal love, intimate love. We're talking about unselfish, non-self-centered, God-like love for each other. And when we have that kind of love, then we are able to keep that commitment. We are able to willfully stay in that relationship, no matter how rocky or how smooth it may be. And I imagine, and I'm not going to ask for hands or anything, but I imagine everyone here that's married, who's been married for any length of time, 20 years or more, I bet that somewhere or one time in your marriage you thought about, do I still want to stay married to this person? But sometime the old devil came along and started tempting you that maybe somebody else would be better for you. Maybe somebody else could do that things for you that this person can't do. When I was served in Hopeful, we had two bizarre cases, couples who had been married for a long time. And both of them, it wasn't the husband ran out on the wife. It was the wife ran out on the husband and their kids. You always hear this about women are supposed to have this natural maternal instinct. Both of these women ran out on their kids. For one, the woman was not able to have children. So they had adopted two children. A little girl who looked like a perfect Anglo-Saxon, Northern European, blonde hair, blue eyes, and then a little Korean boy. And they were, the little boy was only about 6 years old. She took off with someone again. Didn't want to be bothered with children anymore. Same in the other situation. They had children who both been involved very much in church. Her husband was a supervisor for the Hemmer Construction Company. If you ever go through Northern Kentucky down I-75, when you get around Fort Wright, Erlanger, that area, you see a big building that says Hemmer. It's Hemmer Construction. It's huge in Cincinnati. Bill Hemmer used to do sports on one of the Cincinnati TV stations, and then went to CBS or somewhere, and now it's on another TV station. He was a nephew of the construction. Well, this husband was a supervisor for them. His wife was working in a bank. He started having an affair with the vice president and left her children and her husband. But this vice president was cool. He had prestige. He was a vice president of the bank. He wasn't a supervisor for a construction. Like, that's not something to be proud of. Because it's not like her husband was working for $5 an hour. But she wanted that prestige, and she wanted the fancy trips and all that. These children and her husband. So, obviously, that is where commitment and love failed. She was being selfish. All she thought about were what she needed, not what was good for the marriage. So, to endure, to forgive, that is the true foundation of marriage. Dr. Sternberg gives us the biological reason, passion, intimacy, and commitment. It is enduring, forgiving, and loving that makes sure that our relationship, our marriage, will last for as long as we know she'll live. The sad thing today, that too many young people get married spend more time on their wedding than they do on their marriage. But all this into their wedding, they have to throw this big. I can't believe how much weddings cost them. When Gene and I got married for $500, that was it. I'm not even sure we spent $500. Our oldest son got married, $5,000. I'm going to go any higher, she says more than that. Our middle son, his, was over that much. Of course, our middle son is married. wants to get married, spend all this money on the wedding. 6 months later, they're in my office saying the marriage is falling apart. It's like, how can your marriage fall apart in 6 months? And then the married law, I don't even know what being married is. I was like, oh, no, we need a divorce. No, we need to get a big kick in the hand, slap in the face, knock some sense into your head, and try. You know, try to endure, try to forgive, try to love, have a commitment. Love is a decision. Decide to keep going. So, if you want to be successful in our marriage, you have to quit watching the TV and the movies and the romantic novels, because they're all wrong. They never get it wrong. To do it, to give, and love. And then we will be so that there is love. Peace of God, which passes all understanding, keep your hearts and minds through Christ Jesus.
Amen.
Those who came to that difficulty, please stand. With the whole people of God in Christ Jesus, let us pray for the church, those in need, and all of God's creation. Our response today is, hear our prayer. Let us pray for the church, that we may offer the hand in the healing of Christ to stranger and foe alike. God have mercy. Let us pray for clean air and water and abundant harvest, in generosity to share the gifts of God's creation with those who have little. God have mercy.
Hear our prayer.
Let us pray for conviction and faith like the ancient church father Bishop Irenaeus to sustain us in every hour, that we might persevere and be grateful regardless of circumstances. God have mercy.
Hear our prayer.
Let us pray for songs of faith and for musicians, poets, and composers who put the gospel of Christ on our lips. God have mercy.
Hear our prayer.
Let us pray that the wounds of Christ connect us to the wounds of the world, and in those wounds we will see, hear, and feel your abiding presence with us. God have mercy.
Hear our prayer.
Let us pray for those whose health and circumstances test their faith and their spirits. Comfort and strengthen those who are ill, and give you all a measure of your power. God have mercy.
Hear our prayer.
Every morning your mercy is new like the new abundant grace. Like the faithful who have gone before us, may we wait for your presence with confidence and stillness. God have mercy.
Hear our prayer.
Loving God, you are near to us when we cry out to you. And to your grace we can endure for whom we pray, through Jesus Christ our Savior and Lord, and by the power of your Holy Spirit. Amen.
Amen.
You may be seated. That is the offering that's collected. Nicholas on the cello will play Sonata in E minor, Opus 1, number 2, Adagio by Guido Marsalis. St. John practices an open communion for all those who are baptized and believe in Jesus Christ as our personal Lord and Savior. We believe his body and blood are freely present in the gathering estate and are of communion age and only in the congregation. We invite and encourage you to come forward with us this day as we gather at the table, O Lord. We continue our celebration with the Great Thanksgiving on page 152. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give our thanks.
Thank you.
By the Lord Jesus Christ, whose precious blood strengthen and preserve you in true faith in the life eternal.
Amen.
Let us pray. O God, we give you thanks that you have set before us the feast of the body and blood of your Son. May your Spirit strengthen us to serve all in need, and to give ourselves away as bread for the hungry, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. This time the congregation may be seated. As we have a special order, special order to celebrate today, and that is the 50th anniversary of Dr. Jim and Dr. Sally's 50th wedding anniversary. We're celebrating their 50 years of marriage. So at this time, we will have a service for the right of blessing of the day. anniversary of your marriage. Let us pray. Eternal God, our Creator and Redeemer, we thank you for providing Dr. Jim and Dr. Sally these 50 years together. Grant that they, abiding in your love and faithfulness, may continue to share with one another their joys and sorrows and all that the years will bring, through your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. A reading from 1 Corinthians. If I speak in the tongues of men and of angels, but have not love, I am a noisy gomer and clanging cymbal. And if I have prophetic powers and understand all mysteries and all knowledge, and I have all faith so as to remove mountains, but have not love, I am nothing. If I give away all I have, and if I deliver my body to be burned, but have not love, I gain nothing. Love is patient and kind. Love is not jealous or boastful. It is not arrogant or rude. Love does not insist on its own way. It is not irritable or resentful. It does not rejoice at wrong or rejoices in the right. Love bears all things, believes all things, hopes all things, endures all things. Love never ends. As for prophecies, they will pass away. As for tongues, they will cease. As for knowledge, it will pass away. For our knowledge is imperfect and our prophecy is imperfect. But when the perfect comes, the imperfect will pass away. When I was a child, I spoke like a child, I thought like a child, I reasoned like a child. When I became a man, I gave up childish ways. For now we see in a mirror dim, but then face to face. Now I know in part, then I shall understand fully, even as I have been fully understood. So faith, hope, love, abide these three. But the greatest of these is love. A reading from the Gospel of John. Jesus says, as the Father has loved me, so have I loved you. Abide in my love. If you keep my commandments, you will abide in my love, just as I have kept my Father's commandments and abide in his love. These things I have spoken to you, that my joy may be in you, and that your joy may be full. This is my commandment, that you love one another as I have loved you. The Gospel of the Lord. Let us pray. God of love, you are always present with your abundant blessing in our hearts. We are especially thankful this day for your grace active in the lives of Dr. Jim and Dr. Sally as they celebrate their 50th anniversary of marriage. Fill them with tenderness and patience, and give them love toward you, for each other, and toward the world. Be with them today and until that day when we all celebrate the marriage feast that has no meaning, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. May you continue to dwell in God's presence forever. May true and constant love provide you, preserve you. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious unto you. The Lord look upon you with favor and give you peace. So, everyone, congratulations. Thanks be to God.
That concludes our 10:30 service. Special music during before the sermon and during the offering was provided by Nicholas and William Ayers, grandchildren of Dr. Jim and Sally Pompuscius. St. John's is located at 27 North Wittenberg Avenue, Springfield, Ohio. Our telephone number is 937-323-7508. St. John's offers a food pantry Wednesdays 9 to 10:45. It will be closed on July 4th, this Wednesday. Our outreach store open Monday through Friday, closed on Thursday from 9:30 to 1. Rainbow Table is every Friday from noon to 1. Everyone is welcome. If you're unable to attend the 10:30 service in the sanctuary downtown Springfield, you can attend the drive-in service out on East 40 at the Melody Cruise Drive-In, 8 o'clock service. Everyone and anyone is welcome. Our organist is Greg Nolte, and again, our pastor is the Reverend John H. Pollock.